All right, hey everybody. So we're going to be looking at threat modeling Jurassic Park with Python. We're going to take a look at what threat modeling is, what happened in Jurassic Park, and tie it all together with some Python. So I am application security at ServiceNow. So I've kind of worked in that space and a lot with mobile application security specifically, and general systems engineering, system admin stuff. Kind of the gamut there. So I did have a pretty sizable bin of toy dinosaurs when I was a child, so I think that helps me with some of the source material a bit. So Twitter, GitHub, LinkedIn, so everything from this today, the code I'm going to go through, and the reports and images and stuff we're going to generate, and the slides themselves are on that GitHub, a fork of the upstream repository I'm going to talk about. So, we'll start with a good quote here. So, when you think about threat modeling, even if you don't know what it is yet, so just keep this George Box quote in mind that all models are wrong, but some are useful. It's kind of like the golden threat model quote, because there's going to be thousands of ways you could do a threat model on the same thing. You would all come up with a different threat model for whatever we would talk about, but they would all be useful in different ways. So, threat model, kind of the formal definition here, a structured way to identify, communicate, and understand the most likely threats of a system and how to mitigate them. So, ideally, this is something that would be done at the beginning of the SDLC, the software development lifecycle. So when, like if you're a developer, if you've gotten your requirements, you're starting to design out how your system works, if you haven't seen it already, what you might start to see as it's kind of trending into the more of a common thing is that at some point you sit down with a security engineer and you go over the design and they try to understand it from their end, sketch out a threat model of everything that you're trying to build and try to find things that you can think about up front and maybe tweak the design a little bit before you get all the way through implementation and potentially have something come up from a pen test or customer reporting something to you or bug bounty or anything like that. So let's go ahead here. On the other side, Jurassic Park, cautionary tale about corporate leadership missing out on threat modeling. They did none of it, I'm sure. So the common four-question framework when you go about threat modeling is going to be, what are we working on? What can go wrong? What are we going to do about it? And did we do a good job? So you hit those four questions, and that's basically it. So dive right into what happened on Jurassic Park, and then we'll think about how those four questions could apply to this. So what happened, this guy, Dennis Nedry, he was the developer they hired. He put malware in what he was hired to build that shut down the security systems so that he could go in, get the embryos, take them, run off, sell them, make billions of dollars. But he died. So didn't work out. So the malware was activated and the security system shut down so he could go do the thing he wanted to do. But it also cut power to some electric fences, which let that guy out, the T-Rex, and that was bad. So, scrambling to fix it, Ray Arnold shut down the entire park system, which terminated that malware, but they didn't have any power. So, flip the system back on, it's on backup power, for some reason, that leaves the rest of the fences disabled, and then the raptors come out, and that's bad again. So, another attempt to fix it, they go all the way over to a power generator, and that woman, Ellie, flips some magic power generator switches over there that bring all the computer systems back. And then when the girl's playing with the Unix system, she finds her way to the security system folder and clicks a file, and the security system reboots, and then the locks engage, and the system is back in the state they wanted it to be in. So from this, here's going back to the first question. What are we working on? So we know we have these things involved here, right? We have a workstation. It's the Unix system, right? It's actually a Silicon Graphics file system navigator, FSN, which was like actually a real thing. And if you want that, you can go. There's like recreations of it that'll just run on Linux if you want to play with the crazy 3D file system navigator. It seems to be connected to some sort of file server or something more of a backend, so we'll just call it a Park file server. And these interface with, there's a security system that's going to be controlling the locks, the door, the actuators, all the physical security stuff. We know we have doors, fences, a staff. We have raptors involved. There's a control room, which much of the scenes take place in. And there's like the area where they wanted the dinosaurs to be, and they escaped that area. Okay. So, for what we're working on, we basically will need to break this down into these five different types of things. So external entities are going to be things outside of your control, right? So something like the actual raptor, like you have no control of what that raptor does. And then there's going to be boundaries. So things like the space where the dinosaurs are supposed to be is going to be outside of a boundary, and then your stuff is going to be inside of it, right? Process is going to usually be like any kind of code or system, something you have like full control of. Data store, where the data sits, and data flow is going to be where like the connecting lines between these various processes or entities. Cool, so this is where, before we get our hands dirty, pytm can come save the day and let you do it all as code and not have to draw a single line in anything. Because traditionally the first part of threat modeling is you're going to need to build some sort of diagram, right? So a lot of people will just do that on a whiteboard, on the back of a napkin, in Visio. There's some expensive tools you can use to do it. Microsoft has a threat modeling tool that's free. That's pretty good as well. But we can do it in Python. So to get started, we need some dependencies here. It's officially only supported in Linux or Mac OS. So I was just doing it in WSL, which is like the Linux subsystem under Windows. But if you're running on a Debian-based system, a simple apt install on a Mac, you can use Homebrew to get the similar package names. Then pull down the pytm repository from GitHub, Python Threat Modeling, and you get in there and do a pipev install. It doesn't have too many dependencies. It should be pretty straightforward. And then you're off to the races. Okay, so we can start out our threat modeling code here by importing some modules from the pytm library. So the different elements I talked about before, boundaries, processes, data flows, those are all specific modules you import from the library and use in your code. So go ahead and import those. Then we create an instance of TM threat model. It's like the main thing you have to import. We go ahead and call the description function here to set a description of what the threat model we are making is. And that's that. Then we jump ahead and we get to start to define some of these things that we want to include in our threat model based on what we learned from looking at what happened in the movie there. So, like I said, we have a Silicon Graphics file system navigator. And we know it's a Unix system, right? So we can create an instance of process here and call the OS function under that to set that instantiation as Unix. So, and then we move on to, you know, we have a file server, so we do the same thing, but call data store in this case, since a data store is explicitly something different in a process. In threat modeling, it's where all the, you know, the data is going to be. It's typically going to be the most desirable target for a threat actor. So we say that's units as well, so why not? And go ahead and set up a data flow. So we create an instance of a data flow, call it Silicon Graphics File System Navigator to File Server. Getting some long variable names here, just to keep it clear. So we go from the File System Navigator to the File Server and call the data flow workstation file server access, kind of assuming that it's like you have a workstation that doesn't store stuff and it's linking up to a file system.
Does that data flow imply directionality there? It seems like it does with a variable name, but is that or is it just meant to be a linkage?
Yeah, it does not. It's meant to just be a linkage, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. So we can make some assumptions here and just say it's probably NFS. NFS runs, it's going to use port 2849. And then we can also go ahead and define the data that exists on that data flow. So we're going to just call it all the park records, complete park records, and set a classification of, we'll just say it's top secret, round up to whatever the highest on there is. It's just sort of an arbitrary classification. So move on. We basically do the same thing again with the security system, the thing controlling the doors and such. So we can say here the max. So the cool thing about this library is we have all these things we can define. If you look at the actual pytm documentation, there's probably like 30-ish, 40 some things you can tell it about a system. And what all this is going to do is later it's going to feed into a like a threat library that comes within this library. So it's going to help you map out some of the threats based on what you tell it about what's in the system. So the more you put in here, theoretically, the more work it saves you later. So yeah, we set up a data flow, say it's NFS again, and basically do the park security system to the file server and call it sensitive. So it's a little down a couple pegs from the other one. Okay, now we think out to the external things. We have doors. We'll call that as essentially that as an external entity. We have what we're still calling a data flow here, the instructions that go from the security server to the doors. We have staff. We know that the staff need to access the file system navigator, at least some of them do, right? So, and we'll just call that a physical protocol because we're kind of leaving software here at that point, getting into physical security. So Raptors are also gonna have a physical protocol with the lock when you think about it. So we're getting a little abstract there. Yep, so that's basically all the code we need. Oh, that's four, so this is five. And then finally we need just to define the boundaries. So we're gonna create a dyno-free boundary, which would be like, inside of this room, you would think, their control room, things like that. People just assume there won't be any dinosaurs in this safe space. And then there's a control room, which should be even more restricted, right? Like only privileged staff should be able to go in there. So yeah, we go ahead and make an instance of that. Put these, all the things that we defined before, like the file system navigator, the file server, the park security system, go ahead and just set an in boundary to say what they're in. And that's pretty much it. And then just wrap it up with a a call there to be able to run it. So you write that, and then you just go ahead and write, run your code. I'm running it in pipfen here to handle all the dependencies as we talked about earlier. So you go ahead and you run the file you created with the DFD argument there, because we want a data flow diagram, which is going to be typically the first thing you create in threat modeling to be able to answer the questions that come after that. We're going to pipe that to dot, which is part of graphviz. It's basically we're just taking, I think, natively pipfen natively the pytm library is going to generate, it's either like XML or JSON, and then dot will render that into an image. So I'll just make a PNG out of there. And then this is what we get from the code. So this is the data flow diagram. So kind of the first real output of threat modeling is that you now have this, then you can, you know, you've, as a security engineer, you could say, I talked to the developers, I understand this is the thing that we are working on, and then go back and maybe talk with some other security people, work out your threats and that sort of thing. Or the other way we see it sometimes is that maybe developers will take a stab at this before they get to their security folks and start to talk about what we're going to get into here. So that answers question one, right? What are we working on? There's a diagram. We made it in code. It shows the, where's the little mouse? Yep, shows the, there's a security system. It talks to the doors and the instructions. I guess to answer your question, it is a directional with the way the data flow is defined. I think there might be an argument to make, to change it to be, you know, either way. So raptors are banging against the door here. So we have these boundaries, right? So dino free boundary, the raptors, we don't want to get through. So that's where we would think about how that might, where the vulnerabilities might be for that to be able to happen. We have the file server, everything's talking to each other. The staff are outside of this control room boundary because you figure there's going to be different sort of staff, so you need a way for authentication to happen there. Okay. So from there, we talk about what can go wrong. And the methodology we use, one of the methodologies to use here is stride. So that's what I'm going to talk about. So stride is basically a brainstorming methodology where you break everything down into spoof, tamper, repudiate, information disclosure, denial of service, or escalation of privilege. So all the vulnerabilities that you could think about with a system should be able to fit into one of these categories. And based on the sort of thing you're looking at, such as a process, data store, a data flow, different ones are going to be able to apply to that. So run through these here real quick. So spoofing is an authenticity issue. So example here, person walks into an office showing a fake badge, right? They're spoofing. Tampering is going to be an integrity issue. Person modifies a video game to have unlimited currency, right? So you assume as the developer this thing has integrity and somebody can bypass it. What can you do to mitigate it? Then repudiation, denial of truth issue. This one's maybe like the trickier one to remember out of all of them. So example here, Bull exits a China shop, says it was all broken when he went in. Like, how do you prove me wrong? You didn't have any cameras. I didn't do it, right? So way to mitigate that. Information disclosure is confidentiality. So, you know, you leave something at a coffee shop you shouldn't have, you get in trouble for it. Denial of service goes into availability issues. So you need to get out of the house. You have an urgent appointment, your garage door won't open. You need the car to leave. You can't leave. You've been denied. And lastly, escalation of privilege would be an authorization issue, such as like when you jailbreak a phone or something, right? You're bypassing escalation of privilege. So I was saying it can vary per element. So this is, I really like this table to sort of show that. So we have our external entities, our processes, which again are the things we're usually most concerned with, because that's going to be like the code we've written or the systems we run. And then we have data stores and data flows. Interesting, the question mark on data store repudiation, like how do you handle repudiation with the data store? Well, the question mark means it's only applicable if the data contains logs, because yeah, if you can tamper with the logs, then you cause repudiation issues. But if there's no logs in there, you don't have to worry about it. So yeah, across the board, process, you worry about everything. But when you're dealing with external entities like the raptors, right, you just need to worry about spoofing and repudiation. Like, is this raptor claiming to be a person? Then it would be a spoofing concern, right? So, data flow, tamper, information disclosed, denial of service. So this is kind of where the brainstorming comes in, because you go back now, you have the stride model, and you have your data flow diagram that you created, and you basically look at every component here, and you think through the applicable threats there. Spoof, tamper, repudiate, information disclosed, denial of service, and escalation privilege. So, let's see. So kind of two I've pointed out here is, I think, two of the most obvious ones we can just simplify it down to is going to be within the process, we have tampering and denial of service, right? Because we had Dennis tampered with the code. He was expected to deliver a code that does this one thing and technically tampered with it to make it do other stuff. And then when the reboot of the system was done, there was a denial of service. And both of those contributed significantly to the issues that happened there. So, and this part's fun because you can, there's a couple points in threat modeling where you could just sort of like go on infinitely, and you have to like put yourself in a box of like, I'm gonna spend, you know, a couple hours on, mapping out the, what all the components are, or doing the exercise here. And you wanna contain it to the most obvious things that you think are going to happen given the amount of time you give yourself, because you can definitely go on and on and on and on. But this tool kind of helps with that, so I'll show you here a bit. So what are we going to do about it is question three, right? So we need to brainstorm mitigations. So let me show you another cool thing that pytm does. So we've identified those two things, circling back, that we believe are an issue. Let me zoom in here. So just, there we go. So, the tampering and the denial of service, right? So there's this really cool, enormous threats.json file in the pytm library. And what it basically is the logic for how a ton of common threats can be identified. So it's going off of these conditions based on what you told it to build your threat model. There's some very specific ones here, like if a process sanitizes input, and some more general ones like the protocol, something is HTTP, or you know, there's one called uses VPN if that is false. So there's just a ton of these in here, and they're all very generic and very good for when you're dealing with like a web application, even like client-side applications, this is gonna be great for. So, but I checked and there's nothing in here about dinosaurs. So I went ahead and added two. The fully supports having your own threat database here. So In the circumstance of like using, I could see using this library over and over again with kind of like a specialized system, and it's going to be perfect for that because you can define all these and get your conditions tuned just right and have it do a lot of your work for you. So I added An insider threat with code changes would be one of the threats here. So if no procedures in place to review code from the system developers, you know, what happened could happen, basically. Backdoor other malware could be inserted. You can define likelihood, severity. So the condition is just set when it's sensitive data, right? And what's the mitigation for that? So code changes should undergo review by the security team prior to entering production as part of SDLC, right? So if they had really spared no expense, right? If they had somebody look at code, even just look at code after it was written before it went to production, that the whole movie wouldn't have happened. So, and the other one I had here, so on the physical security front, you get a fail open with sensitive security systems, something like the door that's supposed to keep a dinosaur out, right? Like should probably fail open instead of, failing open would be the finding. So it should fail on so that the door, if there's no power, the door stays closed. So things like that, you can go on and on and on. Let me go back to.
Does it generate those threats with the stride model in mind, or is it just like its own different heuristics and rules?
Right, so it is, pytm is built to be agnostic for the methodology because there are a number of popular ones. Stride is probably like the simplest one to get started with. But it's definitely built with Stride in mind as like a possible, you know, like if someone makes an issue on GitHub, I've seen it's gonna be a road of like, okay, that's a problem for Stride, but if we change that, does it break these other things? So yeah, it's made to be pretty agnostic.
It seems like with the table that you showed, those are consistent, those dots, like you could be generative about like here's the model and this is this category process and like we could generate the questions to ask on that brainstorming step. I think my follow on would be for you is like you talked about shrinking that space. What kind of techniques do you apply when thinking about how to get the right set so you're not thinking about every possibility?
Yeah.
Different risks.
Yeah. That's still, I think, I don't know. I don't know how the tool could help with that. The traditional way is just to keep it really limited to like the right amount of time, which is a difficult thing to solve sometimes. Because often what also happens is if you start threat modeling something, there's all these other components that really need a threat model themselves. And you don't want to end up with like some giant threat model that has five other threat models in it and it's all very noisy. And so you really have to stay focused.
It could be a combinatorial problem almost of generating things to consider. It's like, where, when do you stop?
That's a million-dollar question.
Yeah, it seems like being fairly judicious about your data classifications cut out because they're all, or at least some of them seem to be tagged with classification. So if you are modeling, if you're writing the model, obviously, if you're picking the right data classifications, if you're designing a system, if you understand the sensitivity of your data, that seems like it would probably filter out some of the findings that maybe you aren't so concerned about for one app, but are very concerned for another app.
That's right. Yeah, it's kind of developing those like internal processes to run your threat models off of. Because also, like, the threat modeling tends to become like streamlined within an organization. Like, there's like a way that it's expected to be done that you know everybody can look at and sort of see how they arrived at that. But it's like totally different everywhere. So. Okay, so came up with some mitigations there. So another thing that pytm can do is generate a report based on everything you've done to this point, right, using the logic that was in that threats database. So let me open up that. What it does, so you run, yeah, so you just run that with the report argument, and then you pipe it to pandoc, which takes the text and converts it into HTML. So that's just one of the dependencies. Where is Chrome. Oh. Close full screen. Such a tease. Okay.
You're using Windows?
Yeah. But I blame Chrome for that. I blame Google. So, okay, so this is the report it generates. It's a fairly basic HTML file. This is, it's fully templatable. This is, I think, included in the repo to be just an example. But you know, anything you can do in HTML, it'll translate over, so you could make it really fancy if it was something you're actually using a lot. So we described this Jurassic Park threat model. We have our data flow diagram. That hasn't changed. And then we start to break out the data flows we described in the code exactly as we described them. So what we called them were from and to, the data that was contained within them, the protocols they used, and if we defined it, a port. So a data dictionary, we defined a couple types of data and classified them. And then it kind of just wraps up with these potential threats. And you know, there's a lot here because we hit some very common things like NFS and HTTP, right? So a lot of them just hit based on that. So in this part of threat modeling, it's basically on the developers and the security people to go through everything and answer, is this threat going to apply to this design that we want to do, right? And if it is, let's bake the mitigation in because it could potentially change the design, right? So then it's an exercise of, the question is, what are we going to do about it, right? So there's a lot of them in here. These are all fairly generic. This is the piece of threat modeling where the security experience comes in the most. Because you have to be able to answer these just on experience and knowledge. But having a library like this to start you off is amazing. So a lot of the tools will kind of, that's where they help out significantly, is providing all that based on what you tell it. So
we, Pytm, does it plug into different kinds of standards? To, like you mentioned, HTTP showed up on here, so a bunch of things appear because of that. Could you plug in, I'm thinking this is state, Department of Defense security standard.
Yeah.
Can they be plugged into this to basically your threat model? Here are the things that from the state guidelines that you might have to consider?
Yeah, so, that's a good question. So there's a ton of standards, as you know. So for an application, somebody in that federal space might be looking at something like NIAP, and it's going to have its requirements. And the legwork, I think, would be that someone would have to build a separate threats.json that maps to a standard like that. They've mapped referencing CWEs at a MITRE, which are these broad categories of types of threats. So somebody's sort of pieced together the specific example threats JSON file. It doesn't try to map to all the things. I think the tool tries to just be you bring us your threat database and we.
So it doesn't have to be pluggable, or maybe it's not
binary
right now or something.
You'd have to have some way of converting the data you have into this format. So depending upon what kind of standard you're using, maybe it already comes in a format similar enough to this that you could convert it over and get going. You definitely have to write the conditions out, but I wouldn't be surprised if somebody was, this is also a relatively newer tool.
Okay.
I think it maybe only popped up a year ago or so. So I wouldn't be surprised if the community started putting these things together for the really specific different requirements. Yeah. Yep, so we had the two we created just to show that they did show up on the report, insider threat for code changes, and when it fails open with a sensitive security system, and the suggested mitigations, right? So.
Can you filter what showed up in this report? So could you filter out, you know, very common, like low-level threats from the report so it's more concise? Or?
You could. I mean, I think you would just, with the tool as it is now, you would just generate this and delete what you don't like, and then share it around. You might not want to, because often what happens when, like, threat modeling at its core, I think, is like a communication starter between the developers and the security people to talk about the right things. And even if, like, something shows up on here, like, flooding, I mean, that's a legitimate concern, or something like really dumb that, you know, you're not gonna, like, if you're not using iframes or, you know, your web browsers have them disabled or something like that, like, it's generally still good to somebody just put a note on it to say, like, this is why this obviously doesn't apply to us, because then, like, next week, some guy that missed the meeting is gonna come in and be like, well, what about, what about iframes or whatever.
In that metadata structure, was there something like an adjudication kind of field that can give you, like, somebody has looked at it and can mark it in there in a structured way? I didn't catch that.
I don't think so. No, so that's kind of, some of the more enterprise-y threat modeling systems, I think, would go into that sort of flow where, like, a ticket is created based on the output of the tool and it's actioned. So this is much more basic. Like, here's the information. So, yeah. You have to do that out of band.
So it's really just like, here's the output data. It's not about the process, mm-hmm. the modeling process that you might apply to do the work.
Right.
Seeking accreditation.
Yeah, because in the end, the threat modeling does nothing by itself. It, like, generates documents for you, right?
Yep.
So, but then it's like, what do people do with it? What do they talk about based on what's in the documents? What kind of questions are brought up? So that's the meat of it, which is really cool because it's, I think, one of the most important security skills coming up now, but you don't have to be, like, super technical to be able to do this. You know, obviously, the more experience you have, maybe the better threats you can come up with. But I mean, you can get started and go to town. So,
do you know? Are there any kind of, like, sniffing tools, or is it really going to rely on just your version control? Like, I'm thinking about, I change my threat model based on new information that I learned about a new component that I missed that was important to the system that was overlooked in discovery.
Yes.
And it's going to generate new potential threats. And is there any kind of ability to be like, what was before and after? Or do you just have to look at, like, okay, I've got my threats JSON over here, and I'm going to dip it with
no. Yeah, so, like, this is, threat modeling is definitely something you want to do, like, when you repeat the SDLC. So you're talking about, like, on pass 2 and 3, when you've already done, like, the bulk of it, right?
To get a more robust model.
Yeah, I mean, you definitely want to not go through everything again for there. So, a couple things, different things could happen. One, if maybe you're, like, adding a new specific feature, maybe they go around, you just focus on threat modeling that specific feature, and it's its own separate threat model without getting bogged down by, like, thinking about everything you already thought of. Or the other thing, that kind of goes back to, like, the other one of some of the, like, pricey enterprise tools basically try to do that for you. Manage the workflows and all that, but with the this tool as it is, I think that's something you could, like, bolt on relatively easy. I think you can get this output not just as HTML, right? So you can get it as something machine readable and be able to whip up something that suits your workflow. So, okay. There we go. Okay, so question 4 is, did we do a good job, right? So, it like we were just talking about, it always comes back to SDLC, it's going to happen again. So, and also going back to the quote, so all models are wrong, but some are useful. So, you, generally, when you go through the threat modeling process, you're going to come up with a ton of useful information, and that's really the only goal. So, what you think you might have missed out on, you can always try it again in the next SDLC. You can totally revise the threat model. You can build out separate, you know, little threat models like we talked about. But it always comes up again, and it's never going to be like the perfect threat model. So you get to keep going and keep tweaking it. So there's a lot of really good threat modeling resources out there. If you're interested in digging in and doing some hands-on stuff. So Adam Shostak is the guy that, like, one of the industry leaders that's viewed as an industry leader on threat modeling. So he has a bunch of classes online. He has some stuff on YouTube, but actually some of his paid classes are on LinkedIn Learning, which the Frederick County Public Library will get you access to with a library card number. So you can get free access to his paid classes, which are awesome. I've taken those. So he also has a book, Threat Modeling Designed for Security, also available at the library or at Amazon. And then OWASP has a ton of great articles as well. Cool, so that's all I got. Thanks to Dennis. Set this whole thing up.
Thank you.
Cool. Right. Questions? So we don't use this yet. Thinking about it, I might at some point. We typically use, so like I was saying before, threat modeling can be done. Like, you can start it out just on like the back of a napkin with doing the diagrams and stuff. So we use Miro, which is, you know, like diagram building. A lot of people just use like Visio, or even you can do a Ghetto one in PowerPoint. But yeah, it's nice because you can really use a ton of stuff to do it. Yeah, so I mean, that's what we do, is to do the diagram, and then it kind of just moves into a Word document for the final piece and gets stitched by hand. Yeah, but room for improvement for sure. Yeah.
Because of the generative aspect of this, it's like my brain keeps getting stuck on like, how do you evolve your threat model to be something better, and like, what tools could you bring to help you discover things that maybe you're not thinking about?
Mm-hmm.
You know, naturally you're using your own brain based on the brainstorming processes that you laid out, like Stride or other things.
Mm-hmm.
But like, we all have gaps in our knowledge, and I'm wondering,
yeah,
what kind of techniques that someone who's getting into threat modeling that doesn't know a lot about it, short of like going off and getting a PhD's worth of research
mm-hmm.
under their belt, could do to have the tools help them say, like, have you thought about this? Have you thought about that? It sounded like there was a little bit of pytm. Is that a pretty common thing, those tools to, like, generate, hey, here's all these categories of problems that come out from different standards that you consider?
I think so. Like, the traditional way is just collaborating and asking, like, different security people within range of you. And they'll all give you different ideas, different threats to think about. But yeah, it's sort of like an intelligence database. That's like the bread and butter of some of those commercial tools to like give you that. So a lot of it's traditionally like, that's the monetized piece. So this is, I think, the library that comes with pytm is the, I feel like, the biggest one I've seen that's just like open source information. Outside of the tool itself. But yeah, I would defer definitely just to the OWASP wiki to get started on like some of those questions, because it's going to link out to a lot of good resources that I'm not thinking of.
Yeah. Does the basic threat list, or the out-of-the-box threat list, or the schema have some way of identifying different types of actors or different motivations of actors?
No. So that would be like different flavors of external entities, essentially. No, that's a good idea.
Yeah. Just trying to think of, you might have someone who's attacking for denial of service, and maybe it's based on, I don't like this company, or maybe it's based on, I want to take them down, maybe I've got this competing company and I want them to be successful and make more money. I'm just trying to think of like different ways to, like, different motivations that different threat actors might have, and how you mitigate those risks. They may be similar vectors, but maybe you mitigate them in different ways.
Yeah, I mean, because we go back for a second on the on like the strides that like. My first thought is like maybe it does it really matter because we have like it all would boil down into different parts of stride, right? Regardless of your motivations, I think your motivations would drive you to one of them specifically, like more than the other. So like a likelihood by flavor of external entity into like what they would be going at the process with. I haven't heard anything in that realm, but it's interesting.
Like an input that would affect the severity of the threats that are generated, that, you know, like you might determine your mitigation is, like, you're going to prioritize this one because you know that your company is more likely to be attacked in such and such a way.
Right,
That's how I can think one way it might be.
Yeah. Yeah, cool. Oh.
I'm new to threat modeling and Python, but you did a great job.
Thanks.
And elaborate, keep it simple. One thing I was going to tug on that same string in terms of like immutability, I'm thinking about how this could be set up as a model where you've got like a back end, like you mentioned earlier, maybe some ERP or enterprise level software where you've got a back end. Could be possible, but you just mentioned something where if there is a quote unquote motivation attribute, is that something that could be added to this, or just basically like going deeper beyond what you know the different areas are, whether it's external process, data store, data store. But going beyond that, like could you add other features to this?
Possibly. I mean, so. They're adding features all the time, or evolving the tool, I should say. So, I mean, with something like that, what is the goal, I guess, to help prioritize things? Yeah, I mean, it's a good question.
So essentially, have it like a drill down option, almost, where you go beyond what those areas are, and say, all right, well, we're gonna drill down and figure out, and I guess my mind's kind of like what Matt mentioned. He's going back to that maybe like an enterprise solution where you've got the GUI and you enter, you know, build in X, Y, and Z, and it'll be like you said, the software development.
Right. Yeah. It's like, how do you take the good ideas that they've done with enterprise software and make it applicable to the open source tool?
Yeah.
The patterns that I've seen that work well is like when you design a really extensible system. So you, like what you just mentioned a second ago is that like what is this team of developers built into it? Which is great, I'm glad they're adding features, but there's a point, certain point is like in order to leverage a broader community, you need to make the core of the software extensible via plugins or other mechanisms, hook points. There's all like, you know, PyTest is a great example of a library that does this well, where they add a ton of different kind of hooks that allow you as the like maybe you want to add motivation to external entities, and if the framework gave you use this and this hook to add behavior to external entities that are processed at different points along the way, then like the core devs don't even need to think about that. It's like a plugin that exists in the ecosystem, and then all over time, like I've observed this again with PyTest, like over time these things kind of compound, and you get like whole different segments that. Like there's a web flavor of PyTest development, there's a data science flavor, and like these sort of spawn out of that extensible story. So it is a really hard, it's a hard problem to solve, which is like where do you put those hooks is like the next kind of question naturally. But that is sort of when I've seen really successful projects like that, like Jenkins and you know PyTest and all these other tools, the way to make it broadly applicable to the community is to open it up to be more extensible, which is tough.
Yeah, totally. I'd love to see somebody take a stab at that sort of
Yeah, my mind is also running towards like the back end of this, where if you've got almost like tags for like, I don't know, entities, and you start dumping them in, and you say, you define your entity, and you start dumping in, like, okay, these are the motivations, and then you can pull from that, and then maybe over time start to count those tags, and then maybe do some modeling based on the model.
There's an interesting like persistence element that is like seems to be missing from the tool. Like, it like here's your model, here's your gonna generate your stuff out of there. But we talked about like flow management of what you're gonna do about it. Are you gonna record what you haven't thought about it? And that doesn't really seem present. And maybe not there wasn't their goal necessarily, but adding in the ability to persist and keep track of data over time would allow for some of those other features that, you know, maybe some of them are in here.
Yeah, I mean, and you have to think about how would it apply at an enterprise level and not just like to a small project. So that's I think part of what makes it so hard,
right?
Like, because what works on one is definitely not going to work on the other.
Yep.
So like I think traditionally in enterprise, like we were saying before, like some sort of ticket or something would get created where like the flow of what happens out of this would be tracked in one place. And then, like, the tool that generated it isn't so important anymore because it's, you know, moved on, essentially. But, at a smaller scale, it would be cool if this started doing that kind of thing.
Do you know how old this project is?
Let's see. I don't have internet connection, but I really think it's like 1.2. I think it was within the past year or so that it really took off.
The license file says 2 years ago.
Oh, 15, yeah. 15 probably months ago, 14 months ago.
People don't usually change the license too much.
Right. Telltale 2 years ago, yeah. Yep.
Yeah, I didn't see it in the scheme of maybe this would be a plug-in type of idea, but I didn't see anything about like the impact of, I saw severity, but maybe not the impact of if a particular vulnerability was displayed, like would the impact be exposure of customer data? Would it be inability to process orders? Maybe that's
right.
Not designed because it's sort of meant to be an agnostic schema.
I guess so, yeah, because like impact is always going to be super relevant on what you're building, right? Because like these are just threats or vulnerabilities, right? And like those are definitely gonna vary for like what component it was hit as far as what the impact's gonna be.
Right.
Yeah.
If it's a cat gift site versus some medical business, the impact is very broadly.
Right. But yeah, and there's a lot you can do here in the templating too, like maybe to get a little bit of that like logic where like maybe if you could build like some of the additional metadata that we're thinking into the threats JSON, then you can do some logic of like if it'll show up or like how it'll nest or what that just within like loops and stuff and conditions inside of the templating language.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
So it sounds like there's other power here.
Oh, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, I only really scratched the surface a bit, or maybe I covered like the majority, but there's like, you can also do sequence diagrams using the same code. So it's
kind of a threat database there.
Yep, that's the file we were looking at there. Same, the threats.json. Yep. Yeah, they say you may supply your own threats.
When you say that's the file, what do you mean?
The file we were looking at in VS Code of just the threats.json,
okay.
Yeah. Yeah, they're just saying you can just completely not use the included one and substitute in your own.
Gotcha.
Yeah. Yep.
You can't expand that. You cannot expand that particular one.
The file?
Yeah. If you go up, the model right there.
This threat?
Yeah, you can't add something like, color of sky or whatever. Instead of like severity high.
Oh, add a field?
Yeah. Can you add a green label, basically?
Oh, yeah, you can add a field. I mean, because this is basically just what's going to show up when you hit it with the templating engine, right? It's like item.severity. It's just looking at.
Okay. So you render your report, it can pick up from those items.
Yeah, like these aren't being processed in like anyway.
So then does that answer the question that was asked earlier about like adding another element to it?
Yeah.
Like another attribute here?
Yeah, I think if you're going all in on like your own threats file or augmenting the one that's provided, then yeah, I think that would do it.
It may not fold it into like the actual processing part itself.
Mm-hmm.
That would be like the code level and the logic, but on some of the reporting side.
Yeah, these are just like fields in, fields out. So yeah.
Great.
Yep, they go into.
Do you have any
advanced stuff here?
Questions for Corey?
Stuff.
Thanks.
All right, well, thanks, everybody.